Following on from where we left in the morning, we will be moving on with more humane aspect. Nationalization and building borders around the nations. The process is all focused on the nation itself, whereas the purpose here in this conference is to draw the attention more to the borderline. And in this panel, we no longer talk about the nation level. We delve deeper down into the border level, and we will go further down, focusing on the humane aspect, human relations, the human capitals. Although disintegrated, the regions are all interrelated beyond the borders. How they exist with the borders, despite the borders, this panel will be a quite dense one. I request the panelists to respect the time limitations, so we will have more time in the second round for questions. Let's start with Vahram Danielyan, graduated from Yerevan State, Modern Armenian Literature Department. He obtained his doctoral degree from that department. And contemporary American literature is his interest area right now. He will be presenting us about boredom as a metaphor for a Karsian existence in the novels. California University, Michigan, Yerevan State University are all the prominent places he pursued his efforts, academic efforts, and he delivers workshops in many places. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Just a little bit correction. I'm researching novel genre generally and never focused on American novel, but anyway, it's okay. I would like to thank Randing Foundation and Distinguished Committee for opportunity to be here. The paper that I'm going to present today actually is second part of my research on cars. The first one I presented last year at Shahid University, and now I'm gonna focus on boredom and border in cars. When Orhan Pamuk's novel Snow, which takes place in Kars, at the foremost eastern border of Turkey, was translated and published in Armenia in 2009, many readers noted parallels with Yeghishe Charents' Land of Nairi, which also takes place in Kars, despite the fact that this seems to be the only overt similarity that two novels share. In all other aspects, it seems that we are dealing with the completely different works of completely different authors who never met and certainly never read one another's work. For, while Charents' work has been published in the 1920s and Pamuk's work in the 21st century, Land of Nairi has never been completely translated into any language accessible for Pamuk. Thus, the only and principal platform for comparative reading is Kars, as a crossing point for the two novels. My reading of Kars, presented last year at Shahid University Istanbul, according to the novels of Charents and Pamuk, compels me to think about these novels again. In the first paper, I was trying to understand the motives of the authors for writing the city from personal experience to historical regularity and writer's politics. For both Charents and Pamuk, the most crucial characteristic of the city is boredom, and here I would like to focus on the different manifestations of Karsian boredom, the materialization of boredom, the criminalization of boredom, and boredom as news. The materialization of boredom. In Charents' Kars, the substance of boredom is stone. In my previous paper, I had constructed my reading as geography of the backward provincial city on the motives of novelizing that geography, how the same spaces acquires identical function in two different novels. On the one hand, the diversity of the buildings gives temporal elasticity to the novels, the sketching of the old and new cities, and the mapping of the collision of the old and the new. On the other hand, the unity of that diversity, the fact that those are just details of the city, embodies the materialization of Karsian boredom. Let us first read Charents' material. In Charents' novel, the old and the new cities have a dividing line. The castle, the bridge, and the church appear in the old city, while the five-story building, the company, trading institutions, and other structures appear in the new city. The antiquities, anything pertaining to the old city, were merely described, whereas the main action took place in the new city. The first to be discussed from the antiquities is the castle. Charents describes it as a stone tyrant and huge stone coffer. The next is Vartan's bridge. For Charents, that fantastic building built by General Vartan is just a huge pile of stones. The third ancient building is the Apostolic Church, which is the same for the Nairians as the Notre Dame for the French. But in Charents' words, the church is merely a gray bird made of stone, or an old stone priest. It seems that the new city, which in fact has been built later, is going to overcome the old stone boredom, or at least it has been conceived that way for constructing a new life. Here is the five-story building which spreads the seeds of the new life and company built on the unyielding base of scientific socialism. However, Charents' reading of the newest Karsian existence doesn't decode itself from boredom, but just an opposite. The five-story cedar transforms into a stone nonsense, and the company, despite being built on the unyielding foundation of scientific socialism, is made of granite. In fact, if the history of the old city is the history of stones, then the history of the new one becomes a history of stonification. The stone boredom is materialized once again out of symbol. It turns into the syndrome of immovable life. In Pamuk's novel, the stone boredom of the past is again the main emphasis. The stone buildings left by Armenians, the stone bridge, the stone castle, etc. It seems that the new buildings were created for overcoming that boredom. Even their names are associated with freshness and new beginning. The yeşil yurt, brewery, pub, meaning green country in Turkish, the tea house, green tailor and friends, and the pastry shop called New Life. The culmination of these new constructions, which gives a fairy tale like quality to everything, is the hotel called the Snow Palace, where the main characters of the novel live. The title of the novel, Snow, itself seems to be called to overcome that stone boredom of the past. As a result, the same snow becomes a new symbol of boredom. And in Pamuk's novel, ice buildings come to replace Charents' contemplation of stone buildings. In other words, Pamuk's curse is emphasized by the stonification of snow. And the same snow, which was called to erase the past and to begin a new page of life, turns into eternal symbol of Karsian boredom. Thus, in Pamuk's curse, snow virtually becomes a material of boredom. Any innovation becomes the very substance of endless chain of boredom. One of the characters in Pamuk's novel confesses that cars, both the city and the people, seems to be unreal. Everyone wants to die or leave the city. But interestingly, neither novel has characters who leave the city. In both novels, cars represents a space which is impossible to overcome. The city's inner time seems to have stopped. One can easily come to cars, but cannot leave it by personal initiative. This too is one of the features of Karsian boredom, the boredom of stone, which in time would be replaced with snow. The criminalization of boredom. The main conflict of provincial environments detached from metropolises, which is the same as from the world, is either the desire to be in those big cities or the attempt to formulate a personal identity by opposing one's own traditional system against the world's. Consequently, it might seem that the performance of various family models should appear in the foreground. But surprisingly, this model is almost bypassed in both novels. Traditionally, family institutions common to small communities do not work here. Family intrigues and betrayals do not enliven the city. They are unable to disturb the Karsian boredom. In Charents, the school directors and teachers' wives betray their husband with the wealthy men of the city, and the only reaction to this are the satirical writing by the students appearing on the walls. In Pamuk's novel, İpek regularly betrays her husband with a newly arrived Lacivert, the leader of terroristic organization in the city. Later on, İpek's sister Kadife becomes his lover. At the end of the novel, Kadife marries Fazil, a conservative young man brought up with religious traditions. The main hero of the novel, poet Ka, arrives in Kars with completely different intentions, but from the very first day finds out for himself that even before the arrival, his main mission was to find his love from the university years and to form a family with her. But the institution of family in Kars is not opposed to the world from where Ka came. Thus, the goal is unrealizable regardless of the concrete mythical development and obstacles. Provincial Kars as a family model is not opposed to the external world. Family happiness is not lifestyle here. There is also another general theme in both novels, the suicide committed by the girls and women. In Pamuk's novel, this thread is more underlined, at least at the beginning, and tends to be an important feature for novelization, the overcoming of boredom. One of the main motives for the poet Ka coming to the city is to cover the stories of women who have committed suicides, which seems to be a possible factor for the outside world for overcoming the Karsian boredom. However, from the very beginning, Ka, after getting acquainted with several stories, reveals for himself that suicide, without any obvious reason, if in a self-explanatory way, have become the integral part of daily life. We come across another woman who committed suicide in Charents as well. One day, Dr. Kasparic's teenage wife unexpectedly commits suicide within her bathroom, and her husband, the doctor who kept himself busy with charitable programs before that to enliven the dull and unattractive life in Kars, reject his plans, joining the drab army of bored people who fill their life with card games. The betrayals, murders, and suicides in Kars seems to be common phenomena. In fact, Kars is neither reminding us of Sodom and Gomorrah nor a suburban town populated with criminal elements. Every single deviation simply becomes a component of the perversive boredom, and we are left with the impression that deviation characterizes Kars as a social and cultural phenomenon rather than norm. On the one hand, the boundary status is imposed on Kars geographically. The city is located between two superpowers. On the other hand, being a border for Kars and the Karsians make any opportunity to move or cross the border impossible. Boredom as news. The boredom media relationship is very interesting in the novels. In Charents, the field of the media is almost absent in our current perception. Inside the city, people are the means of communication, providing the circulation of information through
Thank you.
Through gossip, underlining the questionable nature and inconsistency of such a means. Charents nonetheless often refers to gossip, in some cases legitimizing it, in other words, denying news spread through gossip. Gossip itself is a social phenomenon, on the one hand, a result of boredom, and on the other hand, a means to overcome boredom. Charents uses the means, once again, to confirm a result. In Pamuk's scars, the main function of to overcome the boredom has been undertaken by the local newspaper Border. When Ka appears in the editorial office where they are preparing the next issue of the newspaper, he discovers that among the various articles there is an announcement about him saying that he will perform with the theatrical troupe that had arrived the very same evening and that he will read his most recent poem entitled Snow. Ka is very surprised and he turns to newspaper editor Sardar Bey stating that he doesn't have any poem with that title and that he is not planning on going to the theater that evening. In other words, the article contains wrong information. The editor responded with several remarks which nearly fully describes the Karsian philosophy of media. I'm quoting, "Don't be so sure. A lot of people don't like us because we report events which have not taken place yet. Those who think that what we do is not journalism but speculation are not able to hide their amazement when the event develops just as we had written. Many events take place because we write about them. This is precisely what contemporary journalism is." Editor's words end up with following order, addressed to Ka. "And you, I am sure, in order not to deprive Kars the opportunity to progress along with time, and in order not to grieve us, will write a poem entitled Snow, and then you will come to the show." End of quotation. The field of media does not, in fact, overcome boredom, but it legitimizes the dictatorship of boredom. When the surprising, the unusual, and the amazing do not happen, but are fabricated. The newspaper's name is already associated with the irresistible boredom of the city. The borderline city newspaper Border has the same problem as the city. The newspaper is incapable of carrying out the function for which it exists. It is unable to formulate the reality as news because newspaper itself is a component of a newsless reality. In this regard, there is another interesting prompt in the novel, which needs to be interpreted. During the conversation, one of the characters tells the poet Ka that everybody writes poems in Kars, but no one has a book of poems like Ka. From first sight, writing poems, publishing and having a book doesn't have any connection with the issue mentioned above. And here is the promising prompt. The only bookstore in Kars is called News. In other words, the book aspires to become the alternative to boredom spread by media. The whole city is charged with writing poems, but no one has a book. No one, and Ka himself confesses that writing is merely an act of overcoming a boredom, and for him writing poems is the only way to overcome the Karsian boredom. And conclusion, with the end of the novels narrating Kars, Yeghishe Charents' Land of Nairi and Orhan Pamuk's Snow, the Karsian boredom is exhausted as well. In the previous paper, I tried to read Kars as a space freed from the chain of historical and political cataclysms. In Charents' case, this liberation becomes possible through the catastrophe, when Kars is eventually threatened by a loss of its mission of being a homeland for Karsians, and freeing Karsians' people itself by ceasing being the land of Nairi. The exact opposite takes place in Pamuk's case. Kars eventually comes to belong to the Karsian people, somehow unwillingly taking use of the remission left from Charents. This global change also decodes the Karsian boredom by replacing border consciousness with the sense of being native or foreign. When a newcomer doesn't become a captive, and the one who left can also choose not to return. And the main Karsian news news becomes real. Cars becomes literature, a book and a novel, Land of Nairi and Snow. And perhaps we still can find these novels in the bookstores called news in cars and read them, not out of boredom and the need of overcome boredom, but as a memory of the past. Thank you.
Thanks. De teşekkür ederiz Dr. Danielyan'a. Hem bu
Thank you very much Dr. Danielyan. First of all for your presentation that has drawn our attention to the world of symbols and their representations. Now we'll listen to Fabio Salomoni regarding ambivalent memories and identities in a border region, Kars and Iğdır. Fabio Salomoni graduated from the Sociology Department of Milano University, and since 2013 has been conducting his doctorate studies at Manuk University. He has previously done research on Azeri immigrants and they're being welcomed, the way they're being welcomed in Turkey. And he is also working on a book on labor force, workforce in Istanbul.
Express my thanks to the Arantink Foundation for inviting me. It's a pleasure and an honor to be here in this context. My paper will focus on borderland, on the on Turkish side of Armenian Turkish-Armenian borderland, and on local collective identities. Let's have a very very fast look at the literature, social science literature on border. As a quite widespread statement that in the borderland, identities are fluid and soft because the borderland, the periphery, is distant from the center, the main center of production of strong national identity and central symbols. And that's why the state has a limited political penetration in this part of the country. The second reason is because the borderland, the periphery, is always the place where there are ethnic or religious minorities. In this perspective, borderland and sites characterized by culture plus culture rather than culture against culture, which is a quotation from Herzfeld and Anders. Later, other scholars challenged this view, saying that the cross-border communication and movement can solidify identities and can make them rigid and harder. Why? Because of local dynamics, cross-border contacts create new dangers and new threats. And also local memories and the relevance of the past in the present in the borderland can also play a role in this perspective. And other dynamics are the central national ones, dynamics and actors. Concern about the unfaithfulness of the periphery of the borderland make the state presence more extensive. As a summarizing this position, Asting Donlan, another classical seminal scholar on border studies, says that the analysis of identity processes in a borderland should take into account their potential ambivalent character. So in the borderland, we can see both centripetal and centrifuge forces. Let's see how these forces, this relation between periphery and center fit with this our Turkish-Armenian borderland, and which kind of dynamics, local or national, are involved. First of all, borderland means border, and the Turkish-Armenian border is actually, probably, for sure, more impermeable than what it was during the Cold War. In general, the definition, the category of borderlands gives to this region a homogeneous character. But when we look closer to the borderland, to the region, we see differences, important differences. And in the case of Turkish-Armenian borderland, we see that there are two districts involved, two districts sharing the Armenian borders and sharing crossing point borders, the Akyakai and Alijan. So in fact, when we look closer, we see first this first difference, and then when we look at the two different districts and so to the two different cities, we see other important differences. One important difference is the history of the border crossing point. For example, Akyaka, within the Cold War border regime context, it was a partially open, porous border. It means it gave a limited experience of cross-border communication and contact. This limited experience can also probably be found in the local memory, in the local population. On the contrary, in Alijan was constantly an impermeable border. So in Alijan, in Iğdır, it's much more difficult to have direct and recent experiences with the other side of the border, and also the memories of these experiences. The second point is the presence of other borders, other borderlines in the same borderline. For Kars, the Armenian border, the Armenian crossing point border is the only one. But for Iğdır, there are two other border points. The first one is the Iranian one, which is also closed since 88. The second one is the Azerbaijani, or the one with the Autonomous Republic of Nakhchivan, which is also very important because it has very important effects on and influences on Iğdır at the cultural and political level, because it provoked or it promoted a growth of nationalism, a fortification of the Azeri, local Azeri community identity, and also at the same time a kind of, even is also this one is a quite ambivalent, transborder rhetoric of discourse of one nation, two states. And at the economic level also, this Azerbaijani border is important because there are, from Nakhchivan Republic to other daily suitcase trader and before oil traders, labor migrants, there are investments going from Iğdır to Nakhchivan. And so the border is an important, crucial part of the local economy. So the Armenian border, the Alijan-Armenian border, is less important for the district from the economic point of view. On the other side, for Kars, the Armenian border is crucial on the economical level. There are of course other important differences between the two cities and the two districts, the two parts of this non-homogeneous borderlands. Historical, demographic, for example, Kars has also in the present a more diverse ethnic and linguistics, at least, demographic composition. The economic difference is very relevant. There is in a better position because of the agriculture and, as I said, because of the border trade. Political, there are different political, cultural, probably the Kars one is a more diverse one. Kars has also a quite strong Republican political, cultural history, at least until the 80s. On the other side, in Iğdır, there are a growing nationalism on the Turkish Azeri side, but probably also in the last times also on the Kurdish one. So let's see, in this borderlands, and taking into account this difference, how the literature, the elements like centripetal and centrifuge forces, the relation between local and central actors and dynamics fit in this specific borderland. And I tried to look at the identity formation processes and identity changing processes from two specific perspective. They are two mirrors which allow us to see which kind of actors are involved in the identity process and which kind of identity also produces. The first one is the perception and the relation towards the closed border and the opportunity or the eventual possibility of this opening. The second one is are cultural artifacts, so the monuments and memorials which are in this borderland, monuments, museums and memorials which crystallized meanings, crystallized memories and also crystallized identities. The first is the relation, the perception of the closed border. As for Kars, we see an initiative since the beginning, since the early 90s, there was a very spread opposition and towards decision of the border closing. And the first initiative, the local initiative by local actors, was in the second half of the 90s with a collection of signatures asking for the reopening of the border. The second period of contestation on production of an alternative, more less rigid identity started in years to 2000, mainly this is the period of the mayor Ali Beyoğlu. First different initiative in order to produce more less rigid and to promote cross-border identities and cross-border religion. The first one, for example, the organization of a cultural festival inviting people coming from Armenia and Azerbaijan. And the second initiative, still again a collection of signatures asking for the reopening of the border, which was quite successful. But what about the reaction towards these processes? We can see, of course, reaction coming from national central actors, Turkish state. For example, in 2000, the Turkish police expelled Armenian guests because they haven't their visa. But what is, for me, much more interesting is the presence of another actor, an international actor, which is Azerbaijan. Azerbaijan, in 2004, so when the signature collection started, opened a consulate in Kars, which is interesting because it's raised the protest in Iğdır, because the Azeri community in Iğdır saw itself as a semi-official representative of Azerbaijan in this part of Turkey. So no practical economic reason to open this consulate, but mainly the aim to institutionalize the presence of Azerbaijan in order to be involved, to be able to intervene in the identity process, local process, especially concerning the border issue. The second act of the Azerbaijani actors in the same year, in 2004, was a fly connection between Kars and Baku, which wasn't very successful. And in occasion of the opening day of this fly connection, very important guests came from Azerbaijan. They are members of the Azerbaijani parliament, and one of them, Pashayeva, I guess, made this statement, which made clear the reason, the main reason of this intervention, this activism of Azerbaijan at this level. Later in 2009, when just before the Zurich protocols, the upper border became a reality, again, different actors, Azerbaijani actors, still international actors, try to intervene and to produce some influence of this process. For example, these are the words of the local Azerbaijan consul asking for the non-reopening of the border. What happened on the other part of the borderland, Iğdır? In Iğdır, centripetal tendencies are prevailing in general. They are close to the ones promoted by the center, due to main reason, the growing nationalism in Iğdır, the fortification of the Azeri Turkish identity, and also the role, the activism and the investment, symbolic and practical, by the Turkish state. What about centrifuge forces trying to build a different, more less rigid identity. In the second half of 90s, some economic association, entrepreneur association, went quite often to Yerevan in order to set up some connection, because still Yerevan could be at least an important market for the Iğdır economy, but it was a very marginal and a very discreet initiative. It's at the same time it stopped when at the end of 19 the Armenian genocide issues became an important issue at international level. Then I told about the intervention of the Turkish state in this case of Iğdır. The central actors, state representative on the government, can intervene when there is a potential serious danger towards the let's say dominant identity. For example, after the local election 2009, Cemil Çiçek, who was a spokesman of the government, in some way tried to delegitimate the new, for the first time, a pro-Kurdish, a mayor coming from a pro-Kurdish party. And in 2009, there was a reverse situation, because what was centripetal became centrifuge, and the local identities now is opposed to the one promoted by the center. Again, there are international actors, Azerbaijan international actors, both institutional and non-institutional, try to intervene to reinforce the local rigid identity against government and against this process, Zurich process, trying to build different, more less rigid, let's say, and more cross-border identities. In the Azerbaijani actors, institutional and non-institutional, together with local actors, mainly Azeri Association or Turkish Azerbaijani Friendship or Solidarity Association, organized a few weeks before the Zurich meeting, protest meeting at Alijan border, try protesting again this situation. The second perspective, the second mirror, are monuments and memorial, which are, they are cultural artifacts. They are an objectification of meanings and crystallization of memories. We have two examples in this borderland. The first one is the monument to humanity in Kars. The second one is the museum and monument of the Armenian genocide in Iğdır. This one in Kars. Let's have a look to the actors. Which are the actors who took the initiative? There are, of course, in this case, again, local actors, the municipalities mainly. These are the words of the former mayor explaining the reason of this monument. There were local reaction by the local actors, the Nationalist Party, which is traditionally related to the Azeri community, but main rumors, and also the mayor this morning confirmed that also Azerbaijan played an important role. In 2009, the court ordered the suspension, and then, after the end of the Zurich Protocols process, the central government intervened with the famous Erdogan's word, Uçube, the monster. From the semiotic point of view, clearly this monument represents a human being divided into parts which are trying to reach each other. It is a kind of crystallized fluid identity, which in this sense, this monument represents a site where culture plus culture instead of culture against culture. This is the second monument. This is interesting because concerning the actors who took the initiative, in this case there were central actor or the local representative of the central actor, the Turkish state. It was at least the governor. Then he took the decision to build this monument after a conference on the Armenian issue in 95. Then the construction begins in 97, and then the opening in 99, which is interesting. Also, the people attending this opening ceremony, which are still international institutional actors like Azerbaijani representative Talibov, which is the president president of the Nakhchivan Autonomous Republic and also representative of different Azerbaijani association. Also, the role of the Turkish state is confirmed by the fact that a conference on the Turkish-Armenian relation was organized at the same time in a conference sponsored by the president of the Republic, Demirel. So the central actors play in Turkish central actors plus international actors plays an important role. So in terms of semiotic of these monuments, it's quite interesting because it's a monument including different Turkish style, Turkish materials coming from different Turkish republics, made by Turkish and Azerbaijani architects. The location is interesting. It's a kind of trauma site, but not a real trauma site because the location is not a place where massacres took place in the past. The location is just at the entrance of the city where the ways, the roads coming from the three borders point meet. Is a place which the museum has the Mount Ararat on the background, is visible from Armenia, and inside the content of the museum are general material coming from the graves of the villages around the Iğdır, plus materials telling all the Asala issue. So in these monuments, the semiotic of this museum is plural in some way, is a kind of re or over Turkification of a sensitive space, a sensitive territory, because it's a space which is included between two crucial border. Is at the same time I'm quoting an official website, an aesthetic response to the Armenian claims, is a kind of answer, direct answer to the museum in Yerevan. The architecture in some way recalls the genocide museum in Yerevan. It is a museum promoting a more original, more solid identity, a site of culture against culture. Concerning the Turkification or re-Turkification and the state investments, symbolic investment in this space, in 2009, for a few months after the Zurich protocols, state representative visited the villages where the massacre took place, and they also decide the restoration of the graves and the restoration of the small memorials which were already there. Some final remarks after this very, very, very, very short analysis. First, borderlands as a dishomogeneous space, which we should look at borderland as a dishomogeneous space. There are within this space different local identities which are the product of many demographic, cultural, historical, economic differences. The economy played a very important role in order to shape local collective identities. Also, the presence of the state power is different within the same space as we saw in Iğdır and Kars. Another important point is in the literature in general, we see the place for local and central actors, local and central dynamics, and I guess also international dynamics and international actors are involved in these processes. Central national dynamics have always crucial role in shaping local identities, at least in this case. These are a quotation from a newspaper in 2011 trying to describe the situation of Kars and the general feeling concerning the border issue. And the last point is probably when we look at the borderland and also the local collective identity issue, we should also take into the account political and administrative structure of the state, and especially the relation between centralization and decentralization. Thank you.
Salomoni bize
Mr. Salomoni, identification and identity over the nations and the status, how they are adopted by the cities, and the national status of these cities are faced with what variable factors? Very well introduced, and the burden felt along the border. That was a very eloquent way to put it. Thank you very much. I believe there will be discussion about this afterwards. I am curious to find out more about differences between the Kars and Iğdır as opposed to other border cities. Now, it's time to listen to Sayat Tekir. He's going to talk about the presentation titled Looking at Turkey from the Armenian Border. He's from Anadolu University, Department of Business Administration. Right now he is in Department of Sociology in Mimar Sinan University. He is doing his postgraduate studies. He worked in Yeşesin Radio program. He is a good media analyst, and he is a producer himself in this respect. And he has a radio program right now. Now it's over to you. Thank you.
Sandalye.
Looking at Turkey from Armenian border. For this study, I visited Armavir state of Armenia in Bagaran and Yervan Dashat villages. I conducted some in-depth interviews for my dissertation, and I will be presenting a part of the interviews from the field. But before I get started, I would like to thank the organizing committee for this valuable conference. I am honored to be here. I conducted the interviews along the Arpachai River. You won't see a lot of pictures, but this is one of the few pictures I took just to give you an idea about how close I was to the border, and it gives you an idea about what it looks like along the border. This study took place along the Arpachai River, closest area to Turkey border. From a bird's eye view perspective, everything seems to be a perfect whole, a whole structure, but they are separated along the river. Let's have a look at this Yervan Dashat village and its history. Its former name was Herbeklü or Heylibekli. Close to the village, there is an antique place belonging to 3rd century BC. It was destroyed in year 360. The villagers originated from the Turkey side in the past, and after the Turkey-Armenia war, they had to cross the border and settle across the border. As to Bagaran, the other village, it was established by the people coming from across the border in the Turkish side. Those people used to live in 8 kilometers away, distance away from the current village, because in the past, before the Turkey-Armenia war, there was a village with a similar name on the Turkish side, but after the war, those people departed and crossed the border. They were settled in other places, and they didn't like where they were settled, so they wanted to move to another part, but this time on the other side of the border. One of the interviewers said they decided to settle in that specific area, not another place but there, because in the likelihood of the border being opened, they wanted to go back, so it would be easier for them to go back if they stayed close to the border. As you're aware, Russian peace force protects Turkish-Armenia border and there is a military base there along the border. There are observation towers seen. As to the border regime, it's more flexible on the Turkey side, whereas it's stricter in the Armenian side. One of the Armenian academicians said this side belongs to the Russia, the other side of the border belongs to the Turkey side, one academician said, because the rules on this side were imposed by the Russians. The villagers on the Turkish side, the villagers can easily cross the border to move to the Turkish side to come back. But as to the other side, in Yarvandashad and Bagaran, villagers cannot easily cross, cannot actually cross the border. They can do it only with a certain permission document, which allows them to spend 8 working hours on a daily basis for agricultural purposes. And without that permission document, if they, in case they cross it, they are going to be penalized, punished. And for them, it's not allowed to do fishing on the river, only on certain special days, like Easter, they are permitted to do certain things. On the side of the border, actually the border starts not where the border is, it starts from further inside, even closer to the village centers. There's an even internal border before the real border. In order to be able to go to the villages, you need to go through a military control post. But it doesn't exist anymore. Only in the entrance of Bagaran, there is a Russian military base, and they're not exercising any control at all at the moment. But it gives you a slight idea about the border regime still. On the border regime and the frequency of the controls gives you an idea about the perception of a state protecting its people from external threats, but it also gives you an idea about the willingness or about the will of the state to keep its people in the borders so they don't go outside. But still, people on each side of the border perfectly communicate in some way with each other. This is Yarvandashad village. This picture shows us Yarvandashad village. On your left-hand side, you would see the reddish trees, and there is this reddish hill top. That's the Turkish side. The other side belongs to the Armenian side. This is the Arpachai River. The picture depicts the separation by the border. The pictures are not good quality, but still, it makes it gives you an idea. And there are very beautiful pictures and photographs outside in the hall. Anyway, look at this gate on the left hand side. I think you don't see it, but it's a green and red gate. This is where the permission documents are issued so the agricultural workers can go and spend 8 hours on a daily basis working for agricultural purposes. So I couldn't take my time to take this picture. I had to rush at that moment. Anyway, this is the Armenia side. On the back side, you see the Turkey side with the hills. The picture just tells you how close it is. This is Bagaran village. I think it's more obvious here in this picture. You see the farm fields and Ahurian, and beyond that you see Turkey. I made a mistake. I don't know if you can see it, but here, this part, this is the border. One side Turkey, the other side Bagaran. One side Halkışla, the other side Bagaran. And you see the border and Arpachai. And Halkışla village.
You see apricot trees, they look white. White trees and red trees, they make a distinction. Red trees, Turkey, white trees, Armenia. From a bird eye's view, that's the only difference you notice, the color of leaves and flowers. Now, on to another interesting issue. Well, the border is closed, but that doesn't necessarily mean there is no communication at all. That cannot be true. When I just took up this study, I couldn't see how possible a communication could be, but I know it's possible. In Soviet era, there was an agreement on the use of Arpachai River, and this agreement is very helpful for the villagers to get together and to communicate with each other. From spring till fall, twice a month, and each time on the other side of the border, they get together from the two villages to decide how to use the water. Of course, these are the military personnel and the interpreters get together. And they know each other's features and traits. They know what costs how much on each other's side. And they have some special days to measure the water for the calculations. They have lunch or dinner together. They offer cigarettes to each other. That's how the exchange is. In Bagaran, some people watch Turkish television and they listen to Turkish language. The numbers are higher there. In Yervandasha, the interaction is much less. They adopt the narrative of the state. Well, this is the pictures were from Ground Zero, so-called Ground Zero, the borderline. In Bagaran and Yervandashat, people are quite hopeful for the border to get opened. As a person from Turkey, when you go there, when you ask them about their opinion, well, they ask you about your opinion, and I see they're quite hopeful. And you know, the protocols process was suspended, but on both sides, there were a lot of people, majority of people on both sides were willing to see the border opened. But at that time, there was this issue of a flight being conducted in between. Some people didn't want the border to be opened, and you may wonder why. They don't want the border to get opened, especially in places where there is less interaction and communication. Since there is not enough communication, they are scared of the other. They fear. They don't know what people are like there, who lives there across the border in Turkey. But in places where there is higher interaction, like in Bagaran village, they don't feel this fear. And they're more hopeful. And they know the ethnicity of the other people on the other side. Of course, there are different narratives on both sides. Some are nationalists, some are on the other side of the spectrum. So due to lack of communication, they don't know each other. And there is a gap in their minds about the image of a Turk. Of course, there is this narrative of Karabakh war, the genocide, the former Azeri neighborhood, and the classical history narrative of the state. So, in the end, they don't know who is there living across the border, and there is this feeling of fear. And what is quite striking is as follows. Some person said, I wish the border was opened
but it's better if it's closed because when I'm walking down the street, I feel safe this way. Another person said, I don't want the border to get open. I'm scared because we're enemies to each other. We're better off away from each other. Keep it up. Keep it closed. Another interviewer said, there is this fear of occupation. There are 70 million. We are just 3 million. They would occupy us. There would be interaction. It might be good, but I don't want it to be open. Another person said, referring to the economy, if it gets open, we could get closer to each other, but still I don't want it. Our economy is not doing well. We're dependent on Russia. If it's open, Turkey will occupy us. If it's open, it should be based on the protocols. That's how I can quote. Now on to another point. There are Yezidis in the village, and a person said, we treat Yezidis well. And Ottomans, referring to Turks, he said, Ottomans treated their minorities in a way we treat our minorities, in a way that we don't treat our minorities. But I'm not a racist. I hope the relations get normalized, but still I want the exchanges be on an equal footing, and I don't want the farmland to be sold to them, he said. And he also said, if the border is open, Armenians will get across the border, go to Turkey, and Turkish people will see how skillful Armenians are, so they will try to get the border closed again. So on to my final remarks. I want to share two views. In Moscow, in the airport, I saw somebody with a fairly dark skin, and I went up to him and I talked to him and I asked if he was Armenian, and he turned out to be a Turk, and we started to talk to each other, and then I realized that those people are just like us, dark skinned, well, just like me. And on another occasion, I went for fishing. This fishing aspect was off the record, but still, anyway. I was fishing and I saw people enjoying themselves on the other side. They were huddled around a table eating something. They invited me to join them, but I said no. And then we decided to meet on a little rock in the middle of the river. This way I won't cross the border and they won't either cross the border, so we will meet on a little rock in the middle of the river. And we caught some fish, we shared the fish we caught. I put some fish in their basket and they put some fish in my basket, regardless whether we were Armenians or Turks, so they're just like us, unquote. We're the people of the same soil, same territory. And lastly, my last point. Most people try to observe what's happening across the border. Some even have binoculars to see what people there are like. Like in one village, there was no church, so they had to walk to another village. And they hear the call for prayer in a mosque, for example. They get mad and angry to hear the prayer from a mosque because they don't have a church themselves, but they still hear the prayer from a mosque. I asked one of them, how many times do you think in a day you hear a prayer? Some said once, some said five times. And one of them said, when those people hear the prayer, they all rush to the mosque. And they're really curious to find out what life is like on the other side of the border. So, thank you very much.
Şimdi son konuşmacımız.
Thank you very much. The final speaker will be Manuk Avedikyan. Mr. Avedikyan will be delivering a speech on the Yezidi Armenian community's perspective towards the closed Turkish-Armenian border. which will take us to another aspect. The Yezidi community in Armenia, and in fact we don't know that the Yezidis' knowledge about Yezidis spread after protests. Mr. Avedikyan completed his studies in Los Angeles, and he also studied in Armenia in the American University in International Relations and Political Science Department. He is an editor, and he has worked as an editor and researcher at the Genocide Museum in Armenia, and a journalist.
Azınlık meselesi.
He participated in minority research centers activities on reconciliation. Mr. Avedikyan has come with a surprise. Avedikyan worked on non-Muslim minorities and the injustice that they experienced in Turkey, and he also studies South Caucasia, and also studies Abyssinian independence movement and Abyssinians in Caucasia.
I didn't expect that. Thank you. Can everyone hear me? Yes. So I'd like to thank the organizers, and it's funny, Sayat and I know a similar Osman, and I've spoken to him too, but my presentation is about the Yezidi perspective towards the closed Armenian-Turkish border. My slides are pretty much just pictures, so you get a general idea of who's who and what's what and what's going on with Yezidis at the present moment. So I'd like to start with, in 2014, of this year, I attended a concert in Yerevan, which was organized by representatives of Armenia's national minorities, and each community showcased a piece of their community's cultural wealth. My Istanbul Armenian friend had told me about it. He had Kurdish friends in the Kurdish community, and he had invited me, and to my amazement, in my exactly 2 years of living in the 98% ethnically Armenian Armenia, I finally felt like a minority in Armenia, which had never happened before. So when the concert ended, my friend and I left with his Kurdish friends who were active in the Kurdistan Komite in Yerevan and were former PKK guerrilla fighters who are now in self-exile. While speaking to them about Armenian sociopolitics, one of the ex-fighters, which I think may have said something similar, but my Turkish is not strong enough, when he spoke about the border opening, he described how it would be great for Yezidis and Kurds because the cultural interaction and the flow of people. But when he spoke about it from an Armenian, for the Armenian state, he thought it was horrible because Armenia's poor economy and leadership would be swallowed up like a big fish does a small fish, according to our friend. So the first time, I not only felt like a minority in my ethnic homeland, but also the border issue. I also saw the border issue through, though immaturely, from a non-Armenian perspective. This was a first. This motivated me to attempt to understand the border issue and from a Yezidi perspective. I feel like I'm quite loud. Is that true? No? Okay. Because I'm hearing myself. So to give a basic background, Yezidis are the largest minority in Armenia. They make up only 1.3% of the country. So very, very small. And as of 2011, there were 35,272 Yezidis and 2,131 Kurds, who were mostly Yezidis but identify themselves as Kurds. I had a very basic amount of information about Yezidis in Armenia, and before I embarked on this, and I'd like to give a note that mainly what I knew was due to this one journalist, Onik James Krikorian, who studied extensively Yezidis both in Armenia and Georgia, and it's because of him I now have my basic knowledge, but of course there was research done after. So my So my research intended to reveal opinions and issues that the Yezidi community in Armenia has in regards to the Armenian-Turkish border and its implications being both closed and opened. This entails discussing the issue of memory and history before the border's official constellation some 93 years ago and the experience they've had during the Soviet era up to the present Armenian Republic. In essence, the paper is about the Yezidi perspectives and relations with Turkish citizens, mostly Kurds, and the issues behind them and what that entails for all actors, being Yezidi, the Yezidi Kurdish community, Kurds, and Armenians. Yezidis presently do not have a functioning kin community in Turkey. The only connection they have is a shared ethnic camaraderie with mainly Kurmanji Muslim Kurds. Many Kurds in Eastern Anatolia are keen to the idea of a new Armenian market through stories that we hear through the media, the Van businessmen that wanted the Van Yerevan line. And since Armenia neighbors heavily Kurdish populated regions of Turkey, which are also economically underdeveloped to an extent, it is assumed that Armenian friendly Kurds are more likely to visit Armenia in comparison to Turks. This is the assumption, plus due to vicinity and what we've seen so far. But of course, this is just an assumption if the borders were to be open. Many Yezidis have animosity or a range of other issues with Muslim Kurds, mostly due to modern nationalistic propaganda and historical injustices. This I'm going to be speaking more about through my presentation. However, the foundations for these Yezidi Kurdish relations have already been established and are mainly being maintained between Armenia's Kurdish Yezidi community and the PKK, indirectly or directly, however you like to see. Albeit, all this on a very small scale. It is important for Armenia to understand its social capital in the Yezidi community and the role and issues it currently has and in the future of Turkish-Kurdish-Armenian relations. I feel like this is something already going on and it's necessary to understand what's going on in the social capital. I've decided to conduct interviews with various members of the Yezidi community. The research is small, it was done in a very short time frame. I've only conducted 23 interviews and visited 11 different villages around the country. The scale is small, and interviews have been conducted at only 10 villages. One of the villages has their sanctuary, which you will see a photo of later. And the interviews were also done in Yerevan, in the capital. Participants are from various parts of the country. The interviews have been done according to geographic proportion and with objective of maintaining, obtaining people of diverse professions and statuses within the community. So by population ranking, most Yezidis in Armenia live in the province of Armavir, Aragatsotsun, Ararat, and then Yerevan and Godaik and so on. Since the majority, nearly half of Yezidis live in Armavir province, I try to collect interviews according to the population density and relevance of the community, and also some placing issues. I'd like to mention that the Tallinn region of the Aragatsotsun province I was not able to meet, to go to. That's one of my shortcomings in traveling, but I plan on going there as well. Unfortunately, I haven't gone there. There's many Yezidis there as well. There was a mixed approach to interviews. The majority were based on convenience, hearsay, and on geographic vicinity. Others were pre-selected, often those who were academics or individuals with leadership positions in the community. The intent was to obtain a broad scope of people, from common villagers to religious leaders to civil society representatives and academics. This will be very brief, but I'd like to start with memory before. Across the border and after fleeing east. Since almost all Yezidis, pretty much all Yezidis currently living in Armenia are from across the current Turkish border, and their presence in the region is often due to massacres, war, or genocide from the political authorities of the Ottoman Empire. Due to these realities, due to these realities, interviews often began with people's memory and perspectives towards the border before the first official closure. The present opinion of Yezidis, like their Armenian neighbors, about Turks and Kurds are often contingent on history before 1921 and even up to the Karabakh War. In regards to narratives and stereotypes, for Armenians, Turks are considered the main enemy. This is a basic stereotype which everyone knows, and the Kurds' role comes and goes in this rhetoric, especially due to the Kurdish nationalist movement and its apology for the Armenian genocide. Yezidis also see Turks as their enemy due to their like presence there, but during my interviews, people almost always first mention Turks before anyone else. However, when mentioning the word Kurd, interview participants would often deviate from the Turkish people's role in massacres and begin to put the responsibility on Kurds. The familiar line among most Yazidis were, "Do you know our grandparents used to say that it was actually the Kurds who killed us?" Was a common narrative among a large collective of Yazidis. A female Yezdi academic, Tereza Amaryan, whose paternal side is originally from Gars, explained how her grandmother portrayed Yezdi relations with its neighbors. They had Kurds and Turks as neighbors, and she would always speak negatively about Kurds. She would always say that it was the Kurds who displaced and massacred us. It was the Turks' plan, but it was the Kurds that did it. According to her grandmother, a Yezdi's role in Gars was one of caution in case of being tricked or robbed, while stories of relations with Armenians were quite positive, in which interactions were based on honesty and trust. Many Yezidis, almost all interviews or non-interviews, would always boast their relations with Armenians of being great and without any issue whatsoever. This was often like a pre-recorded propaganda tape, although there was quite a level of genuineness. A Yezidi language teacher who works in the villages, like a 50-year-old Omar Mamoyan, also with roots of Garst, discussed how during the massacres and displacement, they escaped to the Armenian side because they had always been in fraternal relations with Armenians. They were not Muslim like the others. Mamoyan also brought up an important symbol which delineates the present border and the perspective of the Armenian side that has towards the Turkish side, and that was the Arax River. And he discusses his grandmother's stories about crossing the Arax River to safety. Many Yezidis spoke about difficulty of crossing it and the difficulty of people, animals, possessions being swept away along the current. However, once they crossed, they were in safety. The river is a symbol of struggle and division between good and evil for many villagers and many people that I met. During the Soviet period and the border, most Yezidis had a sense of peace. There was a sense of peace for most Yezidis and in Armenians and almost all people in the region. And during its rule, the border was closed and passage outside the Soviet borders was heavily regulated by the government. And as we saw from the early presentations, there were moments where the border had certain agreements, where there was traffic flow. But oftentimes, most people had a very difficult time going across. And I would hear a lot of stories. There was a long list of stories. To be brief but relevant, there are stories where Kurds would scream across the border asking for their relatives. There people would cross the border to find their Islamists, to speak to Islamicized Yezidis. Relatives from Sinjar, from the current mountain that is currently being genocided, would come to the Turkish border to see their relatives and bribe Turkish border guards, but never enter. They would get tricked. Some refugees after the genocide would stare across the border in longing, and her whole life was an issue of longing and missing her old village. However, despite these stories, most interviewees almost always stressed that interaction just did not exist, unless they pertain to stories of border villages or Yezidis who were assigned jobs in Turkey, and this was not substantial. Nevertheless, the Yezidi community slowly established itself in the region. However, due to the Soviet nationalities policy, they were officially considered Kurds. How this affected Yezidis and who did not see themselves through an ethnic paradigm and who maintain animosity towards Kurds and all Muslims seems to be significant to the situation today. The imposition of a Kurdish identity on Yezidis was a contributing reason to the nationalistic movement in the late 1980s. I'm going to miss the whole Soviet history of Yezidis and Kurds. If there's any questions about it, I'd be glad to answer. Due to time issues. But in the 1980s, there was a nationalistic movement that rallied around the Yezidi identity as a separate one from the Kurdish one. However, before the movement, most Yezidis during Soviet rule went along with or accepted the Kurdish status due to its contributions and cultivation to their culture. Despite the cultural progress during the Soviet era, a group of Yezidis led a nationalistic movement revolving around the Yezidi identity. It was mostly by religious leaders and laymen. Aziz Amare Tamoyan, which is the man in both these photos, Karame Salon, and Sheikhs Hasane Mahmud Tamoyan and Hasane Hasanian. After Armenia's independence, Yezidis began creating new institutions and positions for themselves. Aziz Tamoyan, who's pictured there, is the most recognized figure of the movement today. He's a quite old man. like at the present moment. He is the self-proclaimed president of Yezidis around the world and the president of the National Union of Yezidis in Armenia. There's many, many national Yezidi unions in Armenia. Doesn't seem like anyone is really unified. The movement, however, this movement met some resistance from the Kurdish Yezidi intellectuals that were present. However, as we could see just by census figures, as criteria for the movement's success, the Yezidi nationalistic movement clearly beat the previous Soviet policy of Kurds, of a Kurdish ethnic identity. The latter movement's motivations can also be seen as a form of defending themselves from Armenian reprisals against Muslim Azeris and Kurds. Muslim Kurds mostly lived in Azeri like majority villages and also intermarried with them. Because of pogroms and massacres against Armenians in Azerbaijan, Armenians began to force Azeris as well as Kurds to leave Armenia. Approximately 15,000 Muslim Kurds left or were forced to leave during the early war years. Currently, there are about a few dozen, maybe less, Muslim Kurds left in Armenia. Currently, the head of the Kurdistan Komitek, Kanyaz Hasanov, is a Muslim Kurd. There's very few left, but he's one of them. During the opening of the border, or the half clearly not a genuine opening in 1991. Despite Armenia being in a state of war, economic collapse, refugees, homelessness due to the 1988 earthquake, many I spoke to were quite indifferent to the border in the early 90s. After 72 years of the border's consolidation, it seemed like Armenia saw this as a normal blockade or a normal border that they were used to for so long. And they still are used to a certain extent. However, there were many instances of Yezidis doing business in Turkey, and most importantly, the first infiltration of the PKK came into Armenia. When the border opened with Turkey, many Yezidis claimed that they were relatives of the community who sold animals in Turkey for very expensive. Others were involved in various businesses, mostly involved in the leather export. It seemed quite limited to leather and their sheep and cow sales. And the opening border had many consequences with the PKK's Kurdish nationalistic ideology that came in. I'd like to start with in the village of Riyataza, the village head Ahmad Baroyan. He had stated to me once before that once the border opened in 1991, we found out that Shengal, like Sinjar exists, northern Kurdistan exists, that across all of Western Armenia there resides Kurds. When discussing the PKK presence, Baroyan told me that the PKK's presence in Armenia started in 1990. The first person who came to Armenia came to this region and met with me. At the time, I was a director of the Sovkhoz, a state farm, and he came to my office and we invited other members of the community, and he talked about Abdullah Öcalan, Apo. He's a man of new ideologies. We tried imagining how big and important he was. Slowly, the PKK's presence increased, and I thanked the Armenian state for letting their entrance in. This is a Kurdistan Komite office in Alagaz. There's more photos, but I found it quite interesting, and I'll continue. While a large portion of Yezidis who live in the 11 Yezidi villages around Alagaz, who consider themselves most of them consider themselves Yezidi Kurds, the vast majority of Yezidis in the Araratian Valley identify as only Yezidis, not Kurds. This is a street of Jahangir Agha, who's a national hero for Yezidis, who fought during the First Republic on the Armenian side. And they often, Yezidis quite revolve their identity around these national heroes like Usupek and Jahangir Agha. When the PKK began their operations in Armenia, they often visited many Yezidi communities in Armenia. Although they were well received in Alagyaz and other regions, in some certain villages, in Armavir and Ararat provinces and its surrounding areas, Kurdish nationalist ideology and propaganda was not accepted. A 23-year-old Verin Ardashat village, who's from Ararat, would mention that PKK representatives would come to their village about 10 years ago and pass out posters of Öcalan and spread propaganda, but residents would not reciprocate and often not letting them in their house, which is quite customary, since I would not even knock on people's homes and just, I was shocked sometimes. Some villagers in Armavir claim that PKK representatives would not even dare to come into their village, and if they do, they would be kicked out. That hostility or rejection to Kurdish nationalism is reaffirmed by a large portion of Yezidis living in the Araratian Valley and quite up. However, things seem to be slightly changing due to recent events. While speaking to 80-year-old Pir Rıza Koçui Davreshyan and 61-year-old Sheikh Cendi Cundoyan, which are over there from the Ardashat village, when I asked them about Kurds possibly interacting with Yezidis if the border were to be opened, Sheikh Cendi told me that we will never reconcile with Kurds. Barzani says that we are there, that there is no ethnic difference. Then why do you, Barzani, stab the back of Yezidis? Why do you disarm and pull back your troops? However, Ocalan's party showed support and helped the Yezidis. He is helping with everything. We see both good and bad, but we will never reconcile or never live together because they are a different race. They are Muslim. Another Yezidi from a nearby village who had fought in the Garabah War, whose name was also a Media Şengal Union social union staff, Siaban Sadoyan, saw Kurds in a very Yezidi centric view. When asked how Yezidis would react to Kurds in trying to interact with their community, Sadoyan explained. Sadoyan claimed that Islamified Yezidis would be accepted by the community, and that the PKK is not pro-Islam. In fact, opposed an atheist, and he is open to Yezidis, and claims that the Kurds used to be Yezidis. 30% of the community will accept them, but that religion has tainted them. One of the central ideas behind Yezidi nationalism in Armenia is the emphasis of Yezidis historically coming before Kurds, and that Kurds are in essence Islamified Yezidis who left their religion. Of course, this is mostly based on what's going on in Iraq right now. It seems to be oftentimes these villagers would never speak well about Abdullah Öcalan and tell Abdullah Öcalan showing support for the Yezidis in Iraq. The PKK has established themselves in Armenia with the Kurdistan Komite, the central office in Yerevan. They have offices in Alagyaz and Armavir. While Armavir doesn't seem to be functioning quite, but Alagyaz does. The officially registered organization usually organizes protests, press conferences, hosts guests, often PKK-leaning Kurds from Turkey who left Armenia. Who visit Armenia. Recently, former Diyarbakir Mayor Osman Baydemir and scholar Ismail Beşikçi visited Armenia and were hosted by the organization and taken care of and taken to the Alagyaz region, which is often customary for Kurdish guests to Armenia. Earlier this year, a delegation of Alevis, Kurds, and Armenians, Sayat was one of them, came from Europe and Turkey, and they visited to commemorate the Armenian genocide. And they were also accommodated by the Yerevan office. The Komite also included former PKK fighters who have been living in Armenia in self-exile for many years. I spoke to one of 10 of them who works, his name is Osman. He works on cultural programs in the villages, and he's been living in Armenia for about 9 years. According to him, such interactions with Kurds from Turkey happen seldom and need to increase. He believes that governments need to support Kurdish Yezidi relations, but believes civil society would be more effective and genuine. He spoke of a concert and musical exchange program organized by Diyarbakir municipality in last year, where young Kurdish and Yezidi musicians there was an exchange and they gave concerts. However, the Armenian side was not able to find the finances for it, I believe, or they were not able to do it. This past summer, due to the crisis in Iraq, Yezidis from Armenia, not associated to the previously mentioned Kurdish movement, Yezidis that consider themselves Yezidi, visited Turkey for unfortunate circumstances. Many members of the Sinjar Yezidi National Union, based in Armenia, visited refugee camps in order to provide aid to the Yezidis who fled Sinjar Mountain. Yezidis in Armenia collected aid throughout the country and demanded that Armenian government help as well, which they had to do through a protest action, and it took the Armenian government a little bit of time, but they were able to do it. But there were some issues as well. These Yezidi representatives visited Batman, Midyat, Adiyaman, and they also ran into BDP party members who helped them quite a bit of obtaining lists of Yezidi refugees. Over 100 refugees showed willingness to relocate to Armenia. Currently, the idea of finding refuge in Armenia. My time's done? 2 minutes? All right. I want to mention one statement that the president of the Sinjar Yezdi National Union said. His name is Boris Murazi. He claimed that the BDP, that the BDP members who he had met with had asked him to cooperate with each other. Boris said that we would work with them, but not for them. Working for them would go against the interest of Armenia. And this became quite like a theme of Yezdi's loyalty to the Armenian interests. The majority of Yezdis have similarities to Armenians since they both live and struggle. But most Yezdis I spoke to thought about Armenia before their community in regards to the opening of the border, except for the Yezdis in the Alagyaz region, which I can't generalize entirely, but the ones I spoke to. The majority also thought opening the border was positive and beneficial for Armenia. Most also went out of their way to stress that Turkey closed it to punish Armenia. 24-year-old Boris Murazi, who is both a journalist and the president of the union, who was very active, was overwhelmingly for opening the border, however with some reservations, or rather domestic preconditions. He believed the overall economy would get better, but the agricultural sector would be greatly threatened. He believed that Armenia had to prepare itself to take on new challenges that Turkey would pose and be able to export products, or else Turkey would gobble up the economy. Other Yezdis, like the 24-year-old deputy president of the Yezdi National Union, Khidr Khajoyan, who is the grandson of Aziz Tamoyan, had a totally other perspective. He was more defensive and conservative. He believed the current situation was much better. Like many other Yezdis, against the opening of the border, he feared the influx of Kurds and Turks residing in Armenia. He considered that fact as a threat to Armenia's national security. Other Yezdis have stated that economic situations in Turkey's eastern frontiers were so bad that Turkish citizens there would prefer to live in Armenia instead. And this is often immature. Siaban Sadoyan also sees the border opening as harm to the Armenian state. He claimed that the Armenian manufacturing will die out because the Turkish products have better quality, except for leather, and we have no Turkish products. How's my time doing? Done? Okay. One more sentence? Okay. Yeah. Well, the point is that Armenia has social capital within Yezdis for Turkish-Kurdish relations, and there's a lot of in Armenian Nurp issues. There's a lot of fragile, unfortunately I can't think of the English, but there's a lot of smaller issues that the community has that Armenia or Turkey or Kurds have to understand how the Yezdis see themselves and see Kurds, and there's a lot of animosity. But there's also foundations of civil society already in Armenia for such relationships. However, they're very, very small. They're on a very small scale. But it seems as if things in Iraq and people and through interaction that Yezdis seem to see Kurds as somewhat different. There is already establishment of Kurdish-Armenian relations, but like I said, we need to understand what that entails, what issues there are, and it seems like there's quite a bit of issues if the majority of Yezdis are very much against Kurdish nationalism and are very hostile towards it at the same time. I could say more, but that's for questions. Thank you.
Evet. Birbirinden güzel çalışmalar.
Yes, I'd like to thank the panelists for these insightful presentations. There are many academicians working in the field of borders or border conflicts. Now we will try to ask you a lot of questions now that we have you. We will have a 10-minute Q&A session. Let us ask the questions one by one, and please state whom you're addressing your questions. Please, first of all, focus on asking brief questions. If we have more time, we will also take your comments. Let us take 5 or 6 questions. Let us start with you.
Hocam kulaklığı mısınız?
Question is
I'm interested in relation to Afghanistan, that you have extended families that operate across the border. So you have families producing...
Microphone, please. Your microphone is not on.
Phone, please, because of the recording. No, they cannot translating without microphone. Please wait for the microphone. No, sorry.
Do you want me to put the question?
Okay.
This way.
Hello. James Darunian. In Afghanistan, it's quite interesting that across the border there are extended families that, so some make the rugs, for example, in Afghanistan, and they ship them across to Pakistan where those goods are then forwarded. I just wondered if there is any sort of extended family cross-border, or whether that could be a mechanism for improving how things are. Oh, good question. Number three, please. Sayat.
Thank you. Just a simple question with very few words of explanations. So the conference is about the prospect and the boundary. So I think I listened carefully, but I did not hear anything about what kind of effort should be made on the Armenian side. Because if the boundary is closed, it's because of occupation of Western Azerbaijan and because of territorial claims on Turkey. So what can be, what real concrete prospect do you expect as long as Armenia will continue to occupy Western Azerbaijan and taking pride of this illegal occupation? And just a very last word, Mr. Salomoni, you mentioned the massacres of Kurds in Oba without saying it was Turks who were killed. Once again, it is important for the psychology of the people, because what they did, what Armenian forces did in the 1990s is reminiscent of what Armenian force did in Kars in 1918. So, in this regard, without accepting any shortcoming, what kind of prospect do you see? It was my last word.
My name is Farhat. I'm from Hacettepe University, International Relations. My question is to Manuk, and I thank him for his insightful presentation. And I want to ask how the Yezidi community's perception towards the Kurdish national movement affected by Armenian states. If there is any effect of like, I want to learn from you. And second question, how is the relations between Armenian state and Yezidi minorities? Whether the Armenian state accept their rights, how is, if they have an education in their mother language, and I want to learn these issues. Thank you very much.
Merhabalar, hoş geldiniz.
Hello, my name is Özgen. I'm a student at the Political Science Faculty. I was going to ask my question in English, but it will be complicated. Therefore, I'll be speaking in Turkish. I'll be asking my question in Turkish. Well, I've forgot our panelist's name. In fact, I wanted to address a general question. When you think of the recent situation in the Middle East and new arguments advanced, new equilibriums, the situation with the Yezidi communities and the approaching centenary of the Armenian genocide, As you very well know, the Middle East is right now boiling in a sense. And now the independent Kurdish movement is going through. It's golden ages, and Kurds came to the help of Yezidis in Sinjar. And considering the centenary of the genocide, what does the Armenian people or the Armenian community or the diaspora expect from Kurds? I would like to ask my question to Manuk. And also I would like to ask the opinions of the first panelist.
Yes, thank you. My name is Viken Chiterian. I have a question to Mr. Salomoni. You compared the monument and the museum at Iğdır with the one in Dizernagapert. I would like to ask you to elaborate a bit this comparison, because I don't see clearly what you mean. And you showed the picture of the Iğdır monument, behind which is the museum. And if I remember right, the monument is six swords being, you know, held by hands. So for me, it's not very clear, a monument and a museum dedicated to victims showing swords as a symbol. Can you elaborate on that? Thank you.
Hello, my name is Muraden. I'm from Public Television of Armenia. My question is to Sayat. Thank you for your data, but I would like to ask you, which year is this data from, and which exact communities where have you been, and who was accompanying you? Because you told things like Russian military base, passport control, etc., etc., which is like from maybe Soviet times. Thank you so much.
Alalım, ondan sonra bitirelim.
Yes, please. A question.
İsmim Fatma Sarıkaya.
My name is Fatma Sarıkaya.
First wives and daughters of the Turkish diplomats who were shot by Armenian terrorists or heroes, depending on which side you look at it. Do you think their feelings are any consideration when compared to the symbols in the novels you mentioned? And as Mr. Salomoni mentioned about the Turkification of the villages on the Turkish side of the border, how about the deturkification of Yerevan? As you know, it was the Revan province of Ottoman Empire, and the majority were Muslims. And what do you think, the stones of those Muslim mosques were made with different stones than the churches? I mean, how many Muslims are left in Yerevan or in the whole of Republic of Armenia?
Başlayalım.
Let's get started. Yes, please. Microphone, please.
I don't know his name, but this is the Yezdi question for the person over there. So you asked about the influence of the Armenian state towards anti-Kurdish ideology, right? And the state of Yezdi-Armenian relations. The influence of the Armenian state against anti-Kurdish ideology is one of, it's mixed, very diplomatic, very not very bold. During Armenia allowed the PKK to come in, and they're still there. There's fighters in self-exile, and but during Der Bedrosyan's time, even though I'm no expert on the minute details, but I believe there was an exchange for PKK fighters from Armenia to Turkey, and one of the PKK fighters told me that Armenia gave some PKK fighters to Turkey, and right on the border, the Kurdish border guards shot them, and Armenia never returned any more PKK fighters after that. So there was, I think that was in 95. I'm not sure the exact year, but it was Armenians decided not to send it. But so Armenia plays somewhat of an intermediary, between the Kurdish establishment and the Yezidis, because the Yezidis keep showing solidarity in the Karabakh, in the Karabakh movement and in the regime, and they have to play the middleman. And for example, right now there is a Kurdish official Kurds in Armenia, and there are official Yezidis. Armenia could have picked one, could have picked Yezidis or Kurds, because there's very few Muslim Kurds in Armenia, very, very few. They're almost all Yezidi. So Armenia is playing the middleman, and there is, for example, schools in Armenia where they learn Yezidi Eren, which is Kurmanji, but they've changed the name, which is the pro-Yezidi movement, and they learn in Cyrillic, in the Russian letters, and there is also Kurmanji in the Latin. There are separate schools because the community has been divided. Sorry. So they have classes, but unfortunately, from what I've understood, they have 1 or 2 hours of class because there's not enough teachers, and also the relations between Armenians and Yezidis are quite good, but there's some issues that Yezidis don't like to talk about. They're supposed to be representatives of Yezidis in the parliament, but there still has not been. The issue has not been resolved. But other than a few small issues, there is tiny discrimination issues on a village level. Generally, everything is pretty okay. But there are issues, but people don't like to talk about them.
That's it.
Afghanistan example. Well, it doesn't come as a true reality here, because there's ethnic cleansing here in this issue. And Neşe Özgen's Ardahan study is important here. There are clues about this issue in that study. But for this side, in eastern part of Turkey, in Armenia border, I think there are not a lot of extended families who would welcome Armenians. Well, I don't think so. As I said in my speech, there were Azeri people in the Karabakh war. As a result of the war, even before the war or during, I cannot properly remember, but they sold out all the property they had and they moved out. Unfortunately, there was a sudden sharp cut after the border was opened. But Neşe Özgen's Ardahan study was very enlightening to me. For example, on that side of the border, they think they protect the border, and they, on our side, there is this narrative of we protected our land against Armenians. But on the other side of the border, there is the similar narrative. Not the military, but it is us who protects the border here. So they share the similar narrative. Of course, each border has unique features, but this is quite likened to the Georgia border in terms of the rules, because it's a former Soviet border. In certain respects, it bears similarities. I hope this was an answer. As to your question, let me turn to your question. This was data belonging to last year. I conducted this with Digya Karadyan, was accompanying me. I conducted the whole study by myself, Pranish Karadyan. Maybe you know him. Do you? Yes, probably you know. Yes, okay. I think he knows. So he was accompanying me in Armenia Ethnography and Anthropology Institute, Aragulian, Professor Dr. Aragulian, Hanska Krakir Rutyan. It was its beginning in Armenian. And Aragulian contributed to this effort. So I went to the borderline, and Ali Sultan, who was with me taking the pictures, was there. He was accompanying me. But unfortunately, that was the situation at the time when I visited the place.
Any question for me? There was a statement, and I'm leaving it without any comment. Thank you.
Yeah, as for the Oba villages, frankly, I don't remember that I said Kurdish victims. Really. Okay. Yes.
I will repeat for the audience now. Uh-huh. I said, in this context, I think it was relevant to stress the ethnic or religious or whatever you want identity of the people who were killed in Oba. Just that. So.
Uh-huh. Oba, also other villages.
In other villages, of course.
As for the monuments, the comparison I made, saying that there are common points between Iğdır and the museum in Yerevan, is because of the shape of Iğdır museum. In fact, there is a high, tall and tiny tower, which in some way recalls the high tiny tower in Yerevan. And concerning the relation, the contradiction you see, which is effectively a contradiction between the present of the swords and the museum of the victims, the answer is in the name, in the official name of this place, which is Museum and Monument. So it's a museum. One part is a museum related to the Armenian violence in the beginning of the 20th century and more recently in Asala. And the other end is a monument of Turkishness and Turkish culture. That's why. Yes, I guess.
Biraz geciktik ama oturumu.
Let's close the session because we're delayed. Border studies are quite challenging and may end up with conflicts. We stated that at the very beginning. Azerbaijan, Armenia. Okay, let's mention it politically correct. Hayistan, Azerbaijan, Kartveli, and Turkey border. I mean, the Caucasus border. It has a striking difference as opposed to the others. And this is an indication of what a huge need there is for this study conducted by the Hranting Foundation. And on each occasion, when we're working on borders, we see communities on both sides supporting the state narrative to a lesser or greater extent. Sociologically, anthropologically, we work on those narratives. But on this specific border, there is something unique, which is a level of conflict which is much higher. The fact that it's closed, it's not just a simple matter. The fact that the gate is closed, it doesn't just refer to the single gate, closed gate of Turkey. Its opening will be easing the commercial transactions. It will be something beyond that. Researchers, members of academia and democratic institutions, right, defenders of rights, human rights should jointly work. Only then can it be possible, because this is a matter of human rights in the long run. Thank you.